Known around the world as the Professor, he also did much more in television, theater, movies. We're going to hear all about it today. Our guest on Throwback Thursday, Russell Johnson, is here. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Bruce.
Thank you very much for coming.
I'm delighted to be here with you. Thank you.
This is going to be fun. Let's start from the beginning. Where'd you grow up?
In upstate Pennsylvania.
Okay.
Wilkes-Barre, the coal mines, and then school in Philadelphia.
Were you a smart kid like the Professor was?
I wasn't smart. I worked hard in high school. I was a member of the National Honor Society. But it didn't come easy. But I wouldn't say I was smart. You know what I'm saying?
I want to hear about your service in World War II.
Yeah, I joined the Army Air Corps back in 1942. And I became an aviation cadet and became a navigator bombardier in B-25s when overseas.
You were shot down, weren't you?
Yeah. I was in the 13th Air Force over in the Pacific. I got shot down on my 44th mission over Zamboanga in the Philippines on the 4th of March, 1945.
Yeah.
And, we had to ditch and land in the water, and we were shot up pretty good. Radio operator was killed. Three planes down that day. The Japanese started coming out after us, so... Zamboanga is on the southern tip of a finger that sticks out from Mindanao, and there's a little island. We were in the straits there. And the rest of our guys formed a circle, strafed those Japanese boats. And then the Army Air Sea Rescue, which were, they used to fly Navy Catalina flying boats, the Cats. You had to holler Mayday and radio for those guys. They used to circle at coordinates about 100 miles away from wherever the strike mm-hmm. was. Took mm-hmm. them, and they only made about 90 knots an hour, so it took them an hour to get there. Now we were all in these life rafts, these six-man life rafts, and they come in and taxied around, picked us up, and took us back to base. We were 600 miles from base. That's a long way from base.
You were injured there, weren't you?
I was shot up pretty good, yeah.
What happened?
Well, we took a 40-millimeter shell back where I was, because when we were over it, we did minimum altitude work right on the water and skip bombed. Okay, so the bombardier didn't drop any bombs; the pilot did. So when we would go over a target, I would climb over the bomb bay and get on a waist gun, a 50-caliber machine gun. Okay, back with the radio operator, we took a shell that killed him and broke my ankles and put a bunch of shrapnel in me. And then when we ditched, there's a whole routine you have to go through so you don't get killed when you ditch, because that's like hitting a brick wall at 100 miles an hour when you hit the water. And it killed him, and anyway, that's what happened.
That's how you got your Purple Heart.
That's how I got a Purple Heart. And
wow. You know, Gilligan's Island was a fun TV show, and it was nice, but man, you fought in World War II. I mean, you were in the bunch of guys who saved the planet.
That's right, son. You remember that. I was part of that generation. Yeah. I am part of that generation.
After World War II, tell me about the Actors Lab.
Yeah, the Actors Lab is where I went to school on the GI Bill. It was in Los Angeles. The Actors Lab was a great theater school. Was founded and run by people from the old Group Theater in New York. The Group Theater was the theater that Clifford Odets wrote for, and people like John Garfield and Francis Farmer and
Kazan. There,
Kazan was part of that of the Group Theater in New York. But anyway, these people formed this school and theater out in California during the war. They sent plays out and so on after the war. Then they had this school for GIs, people on the GI Bill, and people from the studios. Marilyn Monroe was one of the people that was trained there, the 20th Century Fox Center.
She wasn't in class with you. You weren't there together.
She was not in a class with me, but she was in a class at the lab, yeah. Anyway, I was there for 3 years, good theater training, Stanislavski method. So, you know, I'm a method actor.
Yes. What was the first film? What was the first film?
My first film was a film that Paul Henreid, who used to work in films with Betty Davis, lit the two cigarettes, you know. Mm-hmm. Paul produced, directed, and starred in a film called For Men Only. It was about hazing in fraternities. And I played the bad guy. And it was based on a true story. that happened at UCLA. The writer Lou Morheim was part of that fraternity. Anyway, it was an independent film, and it got me a contract at Universal.
You did some westerns for Universal.
Oh boy, did I do westerns!
I just saw Law and Order with Ronald Reagan the other day.
Did you really?
In fact, I got a little clip here.
I came to tell you, Frame. I just killed Frank Derling. You young fool!
It wasn't his fault. Frank was going to kill him. I saw it.
Who's she? Maria Derling.
Derling.
I just wanted you to know I didn't go gunning for him deliberately. Come on, Maria.
Where are you going?
We're headed for the border.
No, you don't. You're going to stay here and stand trial.
You keep your law and order, Frame. I'll take my chances in Mexico.
Don't start running, kid. I'll just have to come after you.
Well, in that case, maybe I better give myself a head start.
Oh, and that's where you slug him.
Wow.
And that's where you slug Ronald
my
Reagan.
My God, that guy was good.
Yeah?
Yeah, that was Mr. Reagan.
Was he a good actor?
He was a nice man, and he certainly was a good actor.
Yeah.
And he was a great personality. He and I didn't see eye to eye politically, but that's okay.
What'd you think of him? What'd you think of him as a person? You didn't care for Ronald too much?
Oh, as a person?
Yeah.
I liked him as a person.
Yeah.
He's a genuinely nice man, and
yeah.
I'm really very sorry about what has happened to him. That's a terrible thing, and particularly terrible for his wife and those around him who love him, you know, because... But it's an awful thing to lose yourself, to lose who you are. But he was a lovely guy. I just did not agree with him politically, that's all.
Oh, say, also in that movie, you did a very nice love scene with the extremely attractive Ruth Hampton.
Yeah, Miss New Jersey.
Was she Miss New Jersey?
She was Miss New Jersey. And Universal in those days was connected, was one of the sponsors of the Miss Universe contest.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. And so all these girls would be signed to 13-week contracts for, $75 a week after the... And there were all kinds of people under contract. Ruth was one of them. She was a nice kid. I ran into her some years later. She was still in L.A. But, yeah, Ruth was a very nice girl.
Was that your all-time best love scene in a movie?
It was my only love scene I ever... The only one I ever got, I did get to kiss Dawn once.
Oh.
That was an interesting story, too. That was a dream sequence in the show, and I played an old man. I told her, I said, if you kiss me, I'll turn into a prince. And so we kissed.
Yeah, what happened?
And nothing happened.
Oh.
So I did... In the film Treasure of the Sierra Madre, Walter Houston does a kind of a dance when they find gold. I did that kind of dance, And I said, don't believe everything you hear, baby.
Throwback Thursday with Russell Johnson. Got a little something for you here from It Came from Outer Space, 1953.
Don't be afraid. It is within our power to transform ourselves to look like you. For a time, it will be necessary. We would not take your souls or minds or bodies.
All right.
But we'll take your money.
At that point, see, the space aliens had taken the form of you, and so you are communicating with the humans as the space aliens.
There you are.
What was the special effects budget on those old sci-fi movies?
About $3.
Yeah, yeah, pretty nice.
Yeah, that was in the days when, that was... Special effects were very, very limited.
But that one was in 3D, though.
It was. It was a 3D. As a matter of fact, we made that film twice, once in 3D and once in 2D. We shot every scene twice.
A couple other...
There was an imaginary line, in which if you crossed that line or threw anything across that line, it came off the screen, so to speak, in 3D.
Yeah.
And so we shot everything twice. It was an interesting...
When was the last time you saw Attack of the Crab Monsters?
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That was back in '06. So.
Is that right? Wow. Did a bunch
that was a silent film.
Yeah. A bunch of TV appearances. What do you remember about Twilight Zone?
Oh, Twilight. I did two Twilight Zones. That's work I'm very proud of. I did two of those.
Which ones were they?
Well, one was a guy who knew that Lincoln was going to be assassinated and tries to stop it. That was called Back There. And then I did another one with Albert Salmi, an actor named Albert Salmi, in which I played a scientist who had a time machine and brings him from being, he's about to be hung in the Old West, and brings him into New York City in the 60s and he goes berserk, and then he kills me and ends up back in the noose. Those were good shows. I'm very proud of that kind of that work.
Outer Limits, too, I think.
Outer Limits, yeah, as a matter of fact. Somebody sent me a little, you know, they've got a lot of these cards out now. Trading cards, I guess they are.
Huh?
And on all kinds of shows. Outer Limits was one. Somebody sent me one the other day to be autographed. And on the back of it, it said it was the highest rated Outer Limits of the series. That was an interesting show, too, yeah. We played people who brought some plants back from outer space from another planet, and they had spores, and they kicked these spores out and ended up killing us. The spores was kick cereal.
Oh, no, that's, yeah. Is that right?
Yeah, and it was, we had bags of kick cereal. We were eating and dying, you know.
When Gilligan's Island hits the air, and it was 64?
Yes.
64. What was your life like at that point off the set? I picture, you know, TV star living in a big house up in the hills.
Well, I did not have a house at that time. I was still living in apartments. I had two small children, David and Kimberly. And Gilligan's Island afforded me the opportunity to save enough money to put a down payment and get a house. So in the first year of that show, I bought my house.
Were there any critics who liked Gilligan's Island when it came on the air?
No.
No? None?
No, not a single one.
Oh.
No, not a single one. They hated us. They ripped us up and down. But later on, years and years later, Tom Shales, who was the critic for the Washington Post, took another look at it and said, you know what? It wasn't bad at all. But boy, they hated us to begin. We were considered the part of the vast, maybe the original vast wasteland of television by the then FCC Commissioner Newton Minow. That's why the ship was called the Minow. It was named after him.
What, did they just not get it? It wasn't supposed to be drama. It wasn't Twilight Zone.
We were not curing cancer.
No.
It wasn't Hamlet. But I don't know. They hated us. Absolutely hated us.
One thing about that show, it had a first-rate cast. Let's start with Bob Denver. You have said that Bob Denver is nothing like Gilligan.
Well, it's true. Bob was a teacher. Taught school before he became an actor. Bob is very intelligent, very quiet, very sedate kind of person. He's a bright man and a sensitive fellow and a wonderful father. And
Nothing at all like...
nothing at all like Gilligan.
Jim Backus.
Jim Backus Jim was a very funny man. He could start telling you stories and jokes first thing in the morning and never repeat himself all day. He knew everybody in Hollywood. He had wonderful stories about people like George Burns and Jack Benny and those kinds of people. Jim had been an actor for many years. He started out with Victor Mature. I don't know if you know who Victor Mature was, but he was a film actor for years. Big star.
And I know he did Rebel Without a Cause with James
Jim
Dean.
Jim did. He played his father, yeah. But he was a wonderful man, yeah, and he's gone now, sorry to say.
So is Alan Hale. Now, Alan Hale seems to me like that was what you saw was what you get, that he was really like that.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's exactly the way Alan was. And he looked, he could have been his father's brother instead of his son. They looked so much alike. But yes, with Alan, that was Alan. Alan was the same, whether he was playing the skipper or whether he was off camera. He was a wonderful man, jolly, a guy who was up all the time. And if he was down at any point, you never really knew it. And he was a sweet man. I loved Alan very much.
Natalie Schaefer had been in Hollywood for a long time.
Yeah, funny woman.
Yeah.
But she had been in the theater. She was a big star in the theater in New York for years. In the 30s and 40s, and then was under contract to MGM for a long time.
Did she want to do Gilligan's Island? It seems like
no.
A strange move for her.
It was a strange move. I don't know how exactly how it happened in a sense, but it was, I don't know really how it worked, how she got into it, but she did, and she was terrific once she was in it, but I'm not quite sure how that happened to have this... elegant lady.
Now, Tina Louise, I think we all know, didn't want to be on that show either, or at least regrets it now.
Well, yeah, she regrets it now. In a sense, she feels that the character in the show possibly ruined a dramatic career. Okay, it really, in a sense, it affected all of us in one way or another. But the point is that I think Tina especially was very upset. She felt she had a serious career going. Why then she accepted the part, I don't really know. But she did.
Well, Don Wells now. Now, Don seems more upbeat about it. Don seems to have accepted more that I'm Marianne, and she seems more proud of it than Tina Louise does.
Well, yeah, I don't think there's any doubt about that. When we first started the show, most of us had had a career. I had worked for 15 years before Gilligan's, and the other people had all worked. Don was a rookie. This was really the beginning of her film career. But the point is that we've all come to accept what has happened. I've done a lot of work in my time, and people know me as the professor. And that's okay. I used to resent that. But I don't anymore. I realize now that through the years, we have given a lot of people a lot of fun, a lot of pleasure. And people approach me all the time now with a smile and with love, and it's the way it is. But Dawn is terrific. She's an amazing lady and very beautiful and very, very sweet inside.
Can you estimate how many people have asked you why the professor didn't fix the boat?
I think half the population of this country.
I think so, too. And is the answer because it would have destroyed the whole premise of the TV show?
That's right. We would have been out of work.
One episode.
There you are.
People are really passionate about that show, aren't they?
Oh, they are. Well, you know, it's a show that today people pass on, I think, from generation to generation to their children in a way. No one gets hurt. There's no rape, there's no car chase, you know, there's nothing violent about the show. And it satisfies, I think, everybody's, you know, the idea of being on an island, being on a...
it's a fantasy.
You know, it's a fantasy.
For people, yeah.
And everything's going to be all right, you know.
Now, was there discussion on the set about these sort of, okay, why would they bring phonograph records? Why would they have crates of money? Did you talk about that amongst yourselves?
Well, we just figured that you know, that was it. And when people ask us about that, why the stock answer is that showbiz. You know? But, you know, people want to know why the Howells brought all those clothes and so forth and so on. And, you know, and why the professor never changed his clothes, you know. But, you know, just the way it is, you know. You have to accept those kinds of things.
Now, the props were great. The props that they made for the professor.
The props were wonderful. We had the greatest prop makers in the world.
All those things out of bamboo.
Absolutely. Astounding stuff.
Any of your favorites? Do you have favorites?
I don't know, the bicycles and the, and the, you know, some of those things really work, too. I mean, you could generate electricity with the coconuts and water and, all that kind of thing, you know.
Yeah.
It was absolutely wonderful.
The bamboo, was that real bamboo?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Coconut shells, real coconut shells?
Real stuff, yeah.
When you do all those lines about a polyester derivative of an organic hydroxide molecule, did you have any clue what the heck you were talking about?
Well, I tell you what, that's hard stuff to learn, but I'll tell you something about Sherwood Schwartz, the creator and writer of the show. He never had the professor say anything that was scientific that wasn't true. He did not want the professor giving out false information. So a lot of that stuff is true.
But did you get calls from physics students saying, oh, no, anything? So it was all right on the money?
Yeah, I'll tell you something. You just mentioned something. Through the years, I've done a lot of personal appearances and, you know, a lot of book signings and that kind of thing. And any number, I can't tell you now how many people have approached me who are now scientists of one kind or another who said that their interest in science came from watching the professor. It's astounding.
You wrote in your book, and it's called, here it is right here, Here on Gilligan's Isle. You wrote, the original series did some damage to my career.
Well, for years, I'd worked professionally in film and television for 15 years before, and I'd played heavies, basically, bad guys. After Gilligan's, I couldn't get a job playing bad guys. I mean, the casting people and the people who were working in films and decided that I didn't do that. I couldn't do that for some reason. It was a difficult thing to get rolling again. Back in those days when you had a television series and it went off the air, you got put away. That happened to all kinds of actors. Mm-hmm. Today, they got, I mean, people got smart and finally realized if you have a name value from one series, you go, you can put you into another. You have something, you know, and you could move. Today, people move between the soap operas and film. Back in those days, you couldn't do that. You know, I mean, it was astounding how many shows in the 60s, when they were finished, those actors and actresses had a hell of a time getting started again.
So you'd show up for a casting call or an audition, and they'd say, oh, well, you're the professor.
That's right.
Yeah, you can't.
They would tell your agent, don't even send them out. So I played a lot of doctors and lawyers and kind of meow kind of guys, you know. but playing heavies was...
Would that have been a kind of the role, if you could have picked which roles you would have had in Hollywood after Gilligan's Island, would they have been more the bad guy roles?
Yeah, because those are always interesting. Sure. Absolutely. When I started out in film, it was back in the early 50s, and under contract at Universal when I was there with Tony Curtis and Rock Hudson and Piper Laurie and people like that. And you know, the leading men had to be good looking, really good looking. And I wasn't that, so they put you in opposite. They make you play heavies, which was fine.
You were good looking, uh-huh.
Well, I mean, they didn't see that.
You did do a couple of the Gilligan's Island reunion movies, starting with Rescue from Gilligan's Island. Had huge ratings.
Yes, it absolutely did. Yeah, it was astounding. 12 years after the show went off the air.
The next couple were not, I would say, of the same quality as the first one.
No. It's very hard to keep beating a dead horse.
Yeah. Especially once the Harlem Globetrotters
showed up.
What was that all about?
Well, I'll tell you what, CBS had a commitment with them, and they had a commitment with us. They said, somebody in a suit back there said, hey, you know what? Let's throw these guys in this together. We'll get rid of both of us in the same show. But I played basketball against those guys and scored 2 points.
Hey! Okay.
Yeah.
Where do you live now?
I live on Bainbridge Island, which is in Puget Sound. It's about 10 miles out from Seattle. And in the wonderful Northwest. I love it up there. People, it rains all the time. Don't come up.
Are you on the shore? Are you on the water?
I'm close to the water.
Yes.
Yeah.
Nice.
There's a lot of water up there and a lot of cedar trees, and it's really absolutely wonderful place to live.
Are you still acting?
Oh, yes. I do voiceover work up there, radio and television commercials, and narration for industrial films, CD-ROMs for people like Microsoft and that kind of thing.
It's really been a pleasure. Thank you very much for coming out to Indianapolis to see us.
Well, thank you. Okay. You guys are terrific.